We culture. Rap is the new rock and roll. We the rock stars.
It's been like that now for a minute.
It's been like that for a minute, Hedy Stamaine.
Doing a VMA award.
Me and Taylor might still have
a hard time believing that George Bush could be.
Hit the Hedy.
Actually, someone's emotions, you know, that I stepped on, and it was rude.
Something that's always seemed crazy to me is how the media really controls all stories. How one event, due to the media, can have such ramifications and serious consequences, almost overnight. How swiftly they can turn public opinion against you, and how in the blink of an eye you can go from on top of the world to the lowest of lows. The vilification of public figures is something all too common nowadays, but it doesn't matter what you do, it's all about how you respond. The year, 2009, the venue, the VMA Music Awards. Kanye West was not performing that night, but rather was nominated for a slew of awards, as is the norm in his career. What he would do that night was unexpected, but if anyone was to
wild out and he's gonna do something crazy,
it was bound to be him. And the aftermath of the infamous night would have major implications on the rap game as a whole, culminating in arguably one of the greatest albums of our generation, with a backstory almost richer than the tracks themselves. But we're getting ahead of ourselves. Let's start at the beginning.
Everybody want to know what I would do if I didn't win. I guess we'll never know.
West had just come off the back of a meteoric 10 years in his early career, to risking it all and leaving his hometown of Chicago to produce beats for Rockefeller Records, to releasing 4 critically acclaimed albums within the span of 5 years, bursting onto the scenes with a soulful College Dropout, following that up with the genius that is Late Registration, completing the perfect trifecta with Graduation, to pushing the boundaries and expectations of the traditional hip-hop album and inspiring a whole generation of rappers with the heavy synths and deep-hitting drums heard on 808s and Heartbreak. Practically overnight, a spotlight was shone upon him, and with that comes the pressure of being in the public eye constantly, and having to know when to speak your mind, and when to just
shut the fuck up.
This has never come natural to Ye. Like Death and Taxes, one thing that will always be assured is that Kanye will speak his mind. No matter how controversial or unpopular their opinion is, this has been a constant throughout his career. The 2005 Katrina incident.
George Bush doesn't care about black people.
To his comments about slavery a couple of years ago, to the defining moment that's brought us here in the VMAs. All came to fruition due to his need to speak his mind. Ye had been hit with a rough couple of years in his personal life leading up to the awards. The years prior, the death of his mother Donda West hit him especially hard, blaming himself for her death due to him moving her out to LA, where she felt pressured to partake in plastic surgery, which would eventually lead to her unfortunate passing. And if you've listened to Kanye's music at all, you realize how close him and his mother were.
Rap the second verse from the song Hey Mama off the College Dropout, and it says I'll sing the chorus first. It says, hey mama, I wanna scream so loud for you.
The mental turmoil with her passing was deep. It was only worsened by Kanye's then fiance Alexis Pfeiffer, then splitting up with him later in the year. He channeled this emotional turmoil into his album 808 and Heartbreak, which is actually one of his best albums, but the world is not ready for that.
This nigga, you know how people talk about those time travelers? Kanye is a time traveler. That nigga went to damn near 2015 and came back with some soul.
Which was the precursor to the events happening in 2009, with his song Love Lockdown being nominated for Best Hip Hop Video and Best Male Video, being obvious reasons for Ye to attend the event. But it was always all go for him, never really getting a break from performances and the limelight, which could be reasons to why he acted out in this way. I mean, before the night even really begun, I mean, just his outfit, it screamed violence. The open leather t-shirt, the dark glasses, that notorious bottle of Henny, and that haircut. Did they really expect this man to behave? They let him walk in like this and expect him to behave? That bottle of Hennessy with every passing picture just seemed to deplete more and more, handing out swigs to whoever was willing, paired with his less than media friendly girlfriend, Amber Rose. As the night went on and awards were starting to get handed out, a clearly intoxicated West had a front row seat, surrounded by all his peers and critics, to watch the Best Female Video award being handed out. And well, the rest is history.
Yo, Taylor, I'm really happy for you. I'm gonna let you finish. But Beyonce had one of the best videos of all time. One of the best videos of all time.
The unapologetic shrug. The pass back of the mic. Beyonce's reaction. Taylor's reaction. The booing of the crowd. Eventually leading to Ye being ushered out of his seat, unbeknownst to him. The moment was unforgiving, but no doubt one of the most important nights in pop culture history, and a turning point for the man himself. He woke up Monday morning the most hated man in America. Embarrassing the sweetheart of the nation on live television was bound to garner backlash. From celebrities like Katy Perry going on to say, quote, "Fuck Kanye," and Pink, "Kanye West is the biggest piece of shit on earth," to every news outlet treating him like public enemy number one. An apology was issued, of course. Did it seem authentic? Of course, it looked like Kanye had written it and not someone else. As for it being an actual apology, well, this is Kanye we're talking about. I like the lyrics about being a cheerleader. God, this man. The consequences of his actions were immediate. The industry, the media, shunned him. A handful of people stuck by his side, but the large majority. He was an outsider now. His nationwide tour with Lady Gaga was cancelled. No matter where you looked, who you asked, Taylor was the victim, and Kanye was the villain. Highlighted fully in an interview with the Jay Leno Show, which took cheap shot after cheap shot at the rapper, clearly just to garner some attention.
Let me ask something. I was fortunate enough to meet your mom and talk with your mom a number of years ago. What do you think she would have said about this?
But perhaps the most impactful example of criticism Ye faced was from the newly sworn in President Barack Obama. This truly personified public opinion of him at the time.
The young lady seems like a perfectly nice person. She's getting her award. What's he doing?
Why would he do that?
He's a jackass, jackass, jackass.
Kanye now had two paths he could go down. He could allow the public perception to consume him, listen to every critic and person in America, and quit music forever, or respond in the only way that he knows how, with his art. Kanye West, who is currently the richest black man in America, heeded advice from his close circle of friends to escape America, pursue other hobbies to clear his mind. Now, he's always had an interest in fashion, this is clear, from his iconic pink polos and backpacks making a statement back in 2005, to the Red Octobers, which speak for themselves. And before his Yeezy brand would become one of the most lucrative and profitable businesses of all time, the owner would flee to Milan, to Internet Fendi. Yes, one of the most arrogant and commercially successful people of our generation, became a $500 coffee runner. But this was all a side project for him, especially at the time. Ye's bread and butter was as a musician and as a producer. If he ever was to make a comeback and resurgence, it wouldn't be through some half-hearted apology or media campaign like other celebrities, when they inevitably become embroiled in these controversies due to us putting them on such a pedestal. No, for him, it's always been different. The only way that made sense in Yeezy's head to respond was in the most braggadocious, arrogant, backhanded apology he could give them. A piece of art so rich that people have no choice but to respect and welcome back Kanye to his
Mount Olympus.
But there was still a massive problem. There was no way Kanye would be able to keep this project under wraps in LA or in any traditional recording spaces without the media adding further stress and pressure. Coupled with the standards Ye was putting on this album, he needed to get into the zone. Complete focus. This was life or death for him. To not only prove to himself that he was deserved of this comeback, but to shut up every journalist and celebrity that had written him off and villainized him in the media.
First rule in this world, baby, don't pay attention to anything you see in the news.
Thus, our story resumes in the Avex Studios in sunny Hawaii, a self-imposed exile from America to a place Kanye was all too familiar with, retreating there previously for 6 weeks to record, again, the massively underrated 808s and Heartbreaks, all in an attempt to achieve maximum focus. No media, no pressure, just him doing his thing. Ye's standards have always been high. I mean, man, I'm still thinking about Yandy, man.
Ah! It should have been me, not him!
How could he scrap that? But this was him taking it to that extreme. His self-proclaimed rap camp brought forward a number of strictly followed rules that all part of his Magnum Opus would have to abide by. No tweeting, no hipster hats, all laptops on mute, just shut the fuck up sometimes, and a whole host of others. This showed that Ye wasn't messing around. Every track had to be perfection, and that's perfection by Kanye's standards.
The way everything happened though was like focus energy, yo. And actually, I never seen that from a rapper before. I come from Wu-Tang Clan. Y'all know us, five of us show for the concert, the other three late. Some ain't doing it, some is sleeping. You know what I mean? And it's not only his talent that took him to the top. I gotta say, it's his focus.
Speaking of Rap Camp, Ye went all in for this. $3 million of his own money was spent on this album, renting out 3 studios 24 hours a day alongside chefs, engineers, and producers all on standby. Not to mention the importing of an all-star cast of writers, musicians, and technicians, like the luxury car straight from Italy. Established greats who you would expect on a comeback album like Jay-Z, Rick Ross, Mike Dean, and RZA, to some up-and-comers of the hip-hop game, just finding their footing at the time like Kid Cudi, Drake, Nicki Minaj, and Pusha T, all handpicked by West himself to shine a spotlight on them, to some absolutely fucking wild cards which you would never expect in a million years to collaborate with an artist like Kanye, being put on that first class plane to Hawaii. Names such as Fergie, Elton John, Justin Vernon of Bon Iver, who makes songs like this. Come talk to me. Collaborate on a song like this. I'm living in the future, so the presence is my past. My presence is a present, kiss my ass. Now, I'm not telling you this array of cast to show you the amount of people working on this project. 14 people working on All of the Light. But to show how big Ye dreamed for this project, and how he actually pulled it off, this was going to be his best work. In the camp, there was just a massive sense of community. There was a rigorous schedule that everyone had to follow. They all ate breakfast together, reflecting on the previous day, today's and tomorrow's work, after being cooked by some of the finest chefs in the world, heading to the YMCA to play basketball against some of the locals, to eventually settling and arriving in the studios to write and produce around 3, working up to 12 hours at a time. Now, although Kanye did have a mansion in Hawaii, he never actually slept there, instead insisting on taking 90-minute power naps in the studios themselves. This showed how drilled and focused Kanye was in making this album, with songs like Power reportedly taking well over 5,000 man hours, according to the man himself, with a similar sentiment being taken with the rest of the tracks. And listening to the album back to front, you can see that this is no bullshit statement to inflate the numbers. This really was a true work of art. And if you haven't listened to it by now, what are you doing? Come on. From Pusha T having to write his verse on Runaway 4 different times, each time Kanye demanding him be more douchebag, to Kanye West asking Rick Ross to re-record his verse for Devil in a New Dress in the final hour of the album's production, showing how this was do or die for Ye. With Ross delivering the finest verse of his whole career. Looking at my bitch, I bet she give your ass a bone. Looking at my wrist, it'll turn your ass to stone. Everything had to be perfect, all to show the world that this was his comeback. All the hate, all the criticism, they would have no choice but to sit down and listen to the master. The album itself explores overarching themes of Kanye's personal struggle with fame and the mental turmoil that goes with it, to fully embracing the villain persona handed to him by the media, through some of the most violent and braggadocious lines in rap history. It really was how Ye described it, a backhanded apology. Now, as much as I want to, I'm not going to harp on about the themes and the narrative of the album, as I personally wouldn't be able to do it justice. If you are interested in the album's themes, please go listen to the Dissect podcast on it. It's brilliant. But if I'm going to talk about one song, it's going to be Runaway. A chronic autopsy of West himself, analyzing all his insecurities, his fears, and highlighting the duality of the album. On one hand, you've got tracks like Power, which is so braggadocious and arrogant, right in your face. He doesn't need your pussy, bitch, he's on his own dick. But the contrast on that on Runaway, where Ye is so vulnerable and honest. Why this song sticks out to so many people and to me, is that it's Kanye like we've never seen before. For once, he admits that he's not perfect. He makes mistakes. It's almost an apology for his own personality, his own destructive behavior that puts him into these situations, leaving all arrogance and bravado at the door, taking responsibility for his actions. But there's that admittance that he will never change, that you should just run away from him, because he's destructive and he will only mess things up in the end. Any good thing he has in this world, he will eventually be the end of it. For as much as Kanye likes to defend his actions, and stand by the things he said, this admittance was out the blue. And I think the final comprehensible line, "And I don't know how I'ma manage if one day you just up and leave," just always hits home for me. Runaway, if anything, defines Kanye West, and that's why I love it. As for how the album done commercially, well, going triple platinum and being named 17th on the Rolling Stone's greatest albums of all time. Yeah, that's all time. This truly was Ye's magnum opus. And I don't care who you are, this is not a 6th album. You say this is a 6th album to my face and I will hit you. Physical violence.
You may ask why I love this album. Well, I'm always a fan of the underdog, you know? And Kanye's been that his whole career, and this was just the biggest example of that. When a whole country's against him, he believed in himself, he backed himself. And what culminated is a piece of art. My Beautiful Dark Twisted Fantasy fully marked the moment that Kanye West committed to the anti-hero role. Some will always hate him for that night in 2009. Others will glorify him for this album and his previous work. He will always remain this divisive figure, and that's the beauty of it. This was truly one of the greatest comeback stories of all time, and I hope you've enjoyed watching this video.